So I work for Global Health Corps. Global Health Corps is a global leadership development organization, and we're devoted to recruiting and fostering the next generation of leaders in the health equity movement. Health is a human right, and it should be, and it's not yet. And that's what we really care a lot about. We have the solutions, we have the interventions, we have the vaccines to save lives and to improve lives, and yet, you know, every year we see millions of people dying and falling ill needlessly. And why is that? There's an implementation gap. There's a reason that people aren't able to access the care that they need. And that's the case in Senegal as it is in South LA. And we all know that, and we've all been through that and seen that with our own eyes. So we really believe that leadership is one of the greatest levers for change in global health. And that's what we're building, and that's what we're really passionate about. Global Health Corps is a movement of young leaders who are really committed to social justice, who are passionate about solving really, really big, complex problems that can take years, maybe lifetimes. And we're focused on building resiliency, developing vulnerability, investing in community, and embracing a diversity of perspectives and stories and skill sets that we really feel are critical to moving the needle on global health. So as I said, you know, I don't know where you guys are and how you're feeling. It's been a really tough week for me personally. I think I have a lot of thoughts running through my head. It's hard to feel like energized to get up and go, and it also feels like a really important time to reflect on that and think about what can we do. I think everyone here, I'm assuming, really cares about making the world a better place, and you're here because you know that there's something not okay in the world of global health, and you're not okay with that. So you've already heard the backgrounds of the panelists up here, so I won't go into that again, but I know they're really excited to share some of their insights and thoughts and reflections with you, and to just kind of have an open discussion. And I think because we have a wonderfully kind of intimate environment, why don't we just sort of take questions in an ongoing way? So if you have a thought, raise your hand and shout it out. There's no need for us to sort of talk at you for any period of time. We really want to know, like, what's on your mind. Just, I guess, to see a show of hands, for the students in the room, are you undergrads? Are you graduating soon? Where are you at in sort of your life cycle of finding jobs, thinking about global health careers? Undergrads? Soon graduating?
Senior.
Senior, okay. Yeah, so you're like on the cusp, and you're like, shit. Cool. Okay, great. That's good to know. Awesome. So, want to know what's on your mind. When you think about the concept of leadership, which is a term that gets thrown around a lot, and it's like, what do we mean? You know, who gets to be a leader? What does it mean to be a leader? That's really what we want to talk about with you guys today. So I guess I think to just start on that point, I want to ask you guys, when you think about the concept of leadership that you are working to fulfill and that you are sort of manifesting in your daily lives, and you think about your career 5, 10, 15, 20 years down the road, what, you know, what is one of the most salient pieces of being a leader to you, and why is that so important? Like, what does that mean? Anyone can kind of just jump in.
I'll start. My name's Efe again. And I think in terms of leadership, it doesn't take like one quality to kind of move the needle, as we say, kind of push, you know, change within global health. But for me personally, I think it's patience. And I say that because I've worked abroad and I've also worked domestically on malnutrition issues. And as we know, a lot of the issues relating around malnutrition lead to a lot of diseases that are preventable. And that puts a really big, you know, economic damper on the environment and also within healthcare. So I think for me, it's patience in seeing the vision, the greater vision, and patience in knowing that there are going to be challenges and setbacks, and knowing that your vision needs to be aligned with the organization's vision, and that will kind of help you kind of keep going. Patience with your team and trusting your team and knowing that you hired this team or this team is working with you to kind of move that, make that change. So I think for me that was one thing I learned that I kind of strengthened in was my patience for the work I'm doing abroad and domestically.
So when I think about leadership, I think a lot about personal development and vulnerability. Before starting the Global Health Corps Fellowship, I used to think about global health in very lofty ideological terms and then having a very academic approach to global health as a researcher. And most of my work today is about people. I used to think about structural inequality and about systems, but systems in our healthcare systems across the world are made of people, and most of my work is working with community health workers and with policymakers, and it's about really building relationships and understanding their identities and ours, and really working on how we think about power and privilege, because that's so much of my daily work and negotiating that, and it really affects everything from how we think about policies to just the everyday ethics of interacting with people and really understanding what solidarity means with communities. A lot about building our interior life, and I know that kind of we don't talk about it a lot in the global health sphere, but I think it's a really important thing to think about.
Hi everyone, and again thank you for having us here. My name's Chad Noble Tabiolo. For me, I think leadership is opening up space for the people that you're working with and the communities that you're working with, space for them to explore their ideas, to be included in the decision making of what's going to ultimately affect their community. So leading, sort of taking a step back sometimes and leading from behind. Yes, it's important to lead from the front, but also leading from behind and having them sort of flourish their ideas, because ultimately, you know, they are the ones that are going to affect change in their communities, and you want that to be sustainable. And in order for that to be sustainable, you want them to be included. So I think creating that space where, you know, sometimes that sort of navigation of power and privilege and bestowing power, not bestowing power, but empowering your communities, I think is very important. So,
first of all, apologies on the mustaches. It's November this month, so I'm trying to do a part. All of it, right? Like, all of what you guys said is true. I think a lot of how I think about it is trust building. Leadership, I think a lot of people think about it in terms of power, in terms of, like, you know, you want to be a leader. It's nice to be, like, determined or defined as a leader, because you I think there's this implicit thing of, like, oh, you get a lot of power that goes along with that. But I think so much of my career and what my job is about now is actually putting trust in the people who you're working with and potentially who are working for you, and actually, like you were saying, Chad, like empowering them to actually have a voice and being able to be a leader through the people that are actually working for you. So a lot of people talk about that in terms of, like, you know, this concept of servant leadership or something like that, and that's always really resonated with me. But it's I tell all the managers that work for me, is like, their job is to empower the people that work for them and to make sure that they are being as successful as they can be in their network as well. So, yeah.
I think for me, a big piece of leadership is being awake. And right now, sometimes it's not always easy to be really awake. You know, I think, again, just to sort of reference the last week, and I think the entire presidential election has been really tough because a lot of difficult things have surfaced. You know, and we see this backdrop of misogyny and homophobia and Islamophobia and xenophobia, and those are realities here and around the world. And I don't say that to be depressing, I say that to be honest. And I think being leader is very much about being honest with the context you're in, the reality for the people that you're serving, that you're working with. And I think, you know, talking about what's going here at home, you know, it's important to us. When we talk about global health, we really mean the entire globe. And so Global Health Corps works in the US. just as we work in Eastern and Southern Africa, so we place fellows in four cities in the northeast of the U.S. and then in four countries in Eastern and Southern Africa. And we have Americans and non-Americans working in all settings. So we have, we have Malawian fellows who are coming to work in Newark and help us improve our health system there. And that's really important to us because health inequity is something that is everywhere we look. So I know that we have a number of you who work both in the U.S. and elsewhere, and I wanted to sort of ask you, Sonya, maybe starting with you, to talk a little bit about your experience as a fellow in Newark, New Jersey, and what that was like compared to your experience working outside of the U.S.
So, as Jess mentioned, I lived in Newark, which is the fourth poorest city in the U.S. They have some of the highest rates of gun violence, of gang violence, really high rates of diabetes. I was lucky that I had come in to Newark where there was great political leadership, which makes such a difference in how our health systems are designed. Mayor Cory Booker was there at the time. As some of you may know, he's a senator now, and he really believed in health as a human right. So we had even the Children's Bill of the Right to Health. And that was posted on every health clinic that I worked in Newark, which was really empowering. So every child has the right to free healthcare in Newark because of him. So that was really great. But there was also a lot of challenges. As we know, our US healthcare system is really driven by privatized care and by the insurance companies and working abroad. I mostly work with nonprofits that work directly with the government and with the ministries of health. And so it was really different in how I kind of viewed health working here. But I really believe that it's so important to think about reverse innovations when we're working in the U.S. We can learn so much from other countries. When I was working in Uganda and India and South Africa, they really work heavily on the community health worker model, which is really democratizes health, and it's not just in the hands of clinicians that are very highly educated, but it really brings community health workers, many of them who can't read or write, and they're providing excellent care, if not better, than what I've seen sometimes in the U.S. And so we tried to bring that community health worker model to Newark. It was really difficult because that's a very foreign concept here in our U.S. healthcare system. And so I completely failed on that front trying to bring that model there, but hopefully it will come to the U.S. That's a dream of mine, and that's a really great, really amazing innovation that I really, from other countries that I really hope that can come here one day.
So in Zambia, I worked for the Clinton Health Access Initiative, CHAI, which right now it's because of the aftermath of the election, a lot of things are on hold right now in Zambia. But I was a nutrition associate, and what we basically did, we put a business model together to come up with the fortified by baby food that would basically feed the whole country. So all of the inputs of the product would be grown in country. We would build a manufacturing plant. We would build a distribution model. We will make sure we'll have the export-import kind of system. So it was really interesting working more in the business sector, with the business sector on the business side of nutrition, and kind of linking public health and seeing how the private sector can kind of play a role in all of these issues. I don't know if a lot of you guys know, but Zambia has one of the highest stunting rates in the continent. And so what CHAI wants to do, what they were trying to do was create, they're moving away from costing drugs with HIV. A lot of their work has to do with health financing and costing different drugs, and they're trying to move into the nutrition sector. So it's really new for them. We were like the first people on the ground to pilot this program. And it was really interesting because in the US, when I was working in nutrition, you saw more of the overconsumption, you saw type 2 diabetes, you saw obesity. And then over here, we're suffering with more undernutrition, stunting, and wasting. And the concept is kind of, for them, it's kind of foreign to kind of impose this model we see in the U.S. on an issue we see domestically, but health is interconnected. A lot of things we can learn abroad and bring it here, and a lot of things we can learn domestically and bring it there. And so it took a lot of work in looking to our community, not as like we're serving them, but to the community as our partners and making sure that they were at the table making the decisions with us. And, we were even trying baby food and seeing, is this something you would eat? Is this something you see on the market? And so I think it was really interesting, and I'm using what I learned there working, trying to get back into nutrition here and using a lot of those business models there, and kind of that social enterprise linking public health and, you know, the private sector, and finding a seat for everybody at the table. So.
Yeah, I think that. Yeah, I think that we were talking about this a little bit before we met up today. One of the things that I talk about my experience all the time. So I was in the first class. So this is 7 years ago. So it's actually interesting for me. Like, it's interesting for us to share across experiences because we're all like certain years away from some of our actual fellowship time. But the lessons learned there have stayed pretty strongly with me, which is it's very easy to be here and have a conception of what some of the problems are on the ground in a different country or in a different culture or in a different setting. And it's very different when you're actually there. There's a couple different differences. One of them is literally the problems are actually just different than what you thought they were. what you read that's reported on by other people, or what you're told by other people, or what you have a conception of what those problems are very different than what they are when you're actually there. Another difference is when you're there, it's not a conceptual thing of like, oh, that's their problems. You are living in the same community. You are part of the community, and those problems become your problems. So you have kind of two different things happen. Number one, you get a massive amount of conviction to being able to solve those problems because they get very personal very quickly. But the second is, you know, I worked in technology before I came. I continue to work in technology now, and one of the things I was very excited about going into the role was it was a, you know, there was a technology system that they used to track medical information systems that they had there throughout the country, and they thought that there was some problems with the technology. Turns out, I learned very quickly the problems were not at all with the technology. But before I was going over, I was like, hey, you know, we're going to bring mobile technology to this place. We're going to be able to solve some of these problems about data collection. And you get there, and it's like they don't even have power, right? Like, how are you going to get mobile technology to different places? And one of the core problems that you're actually trying to solve is like, how do you get gas to these medical health facilities so that their refrigerators don't run out of refrigeration, so that the vaccines don't go bad, so that they can actually get vaccines to kids and stuff. So it's I think there's a lot of really bright ideas and a lot of interest in global health problems and solutions that happen from outside of those countries. And it's incredibly important, and one of the things I really believe about in sort of GHC's model is that it's not about sort of raising money. It's about like getting people on the ground working to try to solve the problems that are real in these other communities. So it's kind of a long-winded answer, but basically that like the solutions that we know of and that we think about here mean very little in the context of somewhere else where you have drastically either different problems or very different resources and resource constraints that you can actually solve this problem.
Yeah, so Andrew was in our inaugural class of fellows, so he's a risk taker, early adopter. We were founded in 2009, and then since then, we have developed about 750 fellows and alums, which is really exciting. And so, I don't think I mentioned this, I should have, but applications are open for our new class of fellows, open through January 18th, and we're looking for 156 new. So we're growing exponentially every year. And I think as Andrew's background attests to, I think one thing that's really unique about our model is that we're specifically looking for folks who are not clinical people and also who are even outside the health space. So we consider them non-traditional. So people for whom Global Health Corp would be their first exposure to either studying or working in the field of global health, but who have very concrete skills that are transferable. And so IT systems, logistics, supply chain operations, all of those are things that we see a critical need for in the field. And in fact, we work with partners on the ground. We work with about 66 organizations, small grassroots organizations, INGOs like CHAI, and ministries of health. So all up and down the health system across issue areas. And we actually work with them to identify real-time gaps in their capacity. And from those gaps, we develop a job description, and with that job description, we recruit a fellow. So our fellows are going in to fill needs that are very real and there, and that are really hampering these organizations from being able to do the work that they need to do to serve the folks that they want to serve. So that's why we love to see, and you engineers, artists, teachers, in addition to folks that do have health backgrounds, but really trying to broaden the tent and bring in a diversity of skill sets. So I guess speaking of differences, and Chad, I think you mentioned this a bit in your vision of leadership, but I wanted you to talk a little bit more about this concept of inclusion and inclusivity in global health, which I think is a really, really important one. And especially being, you know, if you're someone who's going into another community that you're not from and you're doing work in that community to serve that community, you know, thinking through the power dynamics of that and how do you engage work in a really meaningful and ethical way? And what does that feel like and what does that look like, especially for a leader?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, I wanted to start off, thank you, with what GHC's founder Barbara Bush had wrote in an email last week. In light of the elections and how it's important for, you know, inclusivity of people, conversations, interactions, and going back to inclusion, you know, I'm gay, I'm a person of color, I also did not have a lot of money, and so a lot of the conversations in college and even in grad school was sort of, you know, talking about me, and, you know, made me a little bit uncomfortable, but at the same time made me feel disempowered because I was ashamed. And it wasn't until a little bit later where, you know, I became more empowered, and thanks to GHC as well a couple years back, you know, have helped me become, you know, more, you know, embracing who I am and my identity. But I think going back to, you know, allowing or building in space for people of color or from these minority groups, disenfranchised groups, when you're working in these communities and addressing challenges or problems that they face, you know, it's important to include their voices. And in light of this election, you know, the divisiveness of the presidential election and campaigning, you know, I think it's very important now for all of you guys here and for all of us that, you know, we don't forget why we're in global health or public health, and to keep continuing to build in space to have these discussions and to empower those that might feel disempowered. So, you know, coming from an indigenous, you know, community, often historically, you know, we were left out, you know, on the decision-making table. But, you know, now there's been a lot of effort to include. And I think, you know, that's something to be mindful, you know, when you are young, you know, you guys are all young public health professionals, and to be mindful when you do go into the field to remember that. So to also embrace our differences and be, you know, either embrace who you are, you know, your identities, and also be an ally for those that, you know, are often marginalized. So be a sincere, you know, genuine, you know, ally. Listen, have conversations, understand where they're coming from, and include them. So.
Yeah.
I was like, actually, does anyone else have more to share on this? This is a really important point on, you know, how to stay reflective and humble and grounded and open your arms and really relate to what's happening.
It's just mimicking what I was saying before. It's like, you're going into a new community, you should be listening first. You don't know the first thing about some of the stuff that they're going through unless you've actually been through it yourself. So it's tough when, especially when you're young and you're eager to make a really big impact on whatever you're doing. I think this is probably one of the biggest challenges for GHC fellows that I've heard, both from our year and years after, is that you're like, I only have a year, like I have to do everything as fast as I possibly can, and you know, probably one of the biggest values that you can do for the entire year is just spend time listening and learning from the people in terms of what their actual problems are, because you have a whole lifetime to work on stuff. I mean, this is one of the things that I have taken with me for many years subsequently of the experience of GHC is if you're working on problems and the enormity of the problems that are in this space around public health, and especially in the private sector or the public sector, it's they're hard problems. They're not solved overnight, and they're not solved by one person, and they're not, I mean, it is something where you really have to have the patience to work on it, but you're not going to be effective if you're really not taking the time to understand and invest in understanding what the actual problem that you're working on in the first place. So the generation that we live in and the generation of leaders, you know, millennials get shit on all the time, which is, I think it's a travesty, because I think one of the things that actually is very indicative about millennials is that we really care a lot, and we are very empowered to think that we can have change very quickly. But this is something that I would actually teach back to millennials. It actually takes time to have a lot of change. So be a little humble to just learning first and listening first and acting second.
I love that. Thank you. For me personally, before GHC, I actually didn't really want to be a leader. I really loved just working in the background. I'm very soft-spoken and shy, and it was really hard for me to understand even what leadership means. And I help run a girls' health organization in Northern India, and I often think about what I want them to be, and I live in these lofty, high ideals for them. But I learned, like, if I can't own my identities and how to navigate that and how to be a part of social change in a very meaningful and direct way, how can I expect the girls to do the same? And so it was a lot of inner reflection about that, which we did a lot at Global Health Care Night. I am so grateful to the fellowship for that. And then also it's understanding power and privilege in terms of now being a part of the global health communities here and highly educated, and then going back to India where my family's from. And just last year when I was there working in New Delhi, in the capital, I would have to meet a lot of policymakers, which 99% of them are men, and just navigating that identity as a woman, and then as an Indian who no longer lives there and speaks English and has an accent, and there's a lot of power dynamics with that. So just being really trying to be humble and understand that, and trying to navigate the healthcare system from a country that is so dear to me, but I'm no longer intimately, or people don't see me as a part of that community anymore because I live mostly in the U.S. now. So I think a lot of us come from immigrant families, and we often want to work in the very communities where our families have come from, and just but to also think about our privilege and our distance, as well as our solidarity with them, is also something really important.
I think I just want to piggyback on that for a second, and that point being that a lot of us talk about you go to a new community that, and the community doesn't have to be in another country. And this is something that I think we really miss out here, and miss out on this point here in the United States even, is that a lot of times policymakers can be so out of touch with the people that they're working with. And I actually had the opposite experience. When I was in Tanzania, I worked with people who were Tanzanian, and yet we went to these rural communities, and the rural communities, they treated my Tanzanian co-workers the same that they treated me. You're an outsider. You don't understand what we're dealing with, and we see that all the time here as well. So it's, I think this, it's a barrier that people are just, we kind of continue kind of rolling back into the same problem of thinking you know the problems and not just really being humble and coming in and understanding I might even be tangentially related to your community, but you got to start with the fact of just being humble. I don't know what your experiences, and I don't know what your problems are. So there's weird dynamics then of you go back to India, you were there before, and you have different even accents, different skin colors and stuff like that. I dealt with that in Tanzania, and it was I was counseling my other Tanzanian fellows through this stuff as well, because we were all experiencing it.
Yeah, no, I want to echo that as well. We have all these different layers of privilege already, all of us sitting here. And going into a community, listening, yes, it's very, very much important. But also creating, what was it? My mind's kind of going all over the place. I lost it for a second. Okay, I'll have to get back to it.
Just jump in. We got it. I wanted to see if anybody has any questions. I don't know if you want to talk about something really tactical or pragmatic or why you're here or what's going through your head, but I wanted to kind of just throw it back to you guys and put you on the spot a little bit, because I'm curious, we just unearthed a lot of like really big, heavy things and threw a lot at you.
Sorry, yeah. I actually just remembered.
Oh.
It's the communities that you guys ultimately will be working in, you know, they are the experts. And, you know, many people just cast them aside as, you know, as useless or helpless or hopeless and helpless, but you have to tap their potential. It's there, you know, and you just have to restore that power. That might have been taken away at some point. That's kind of what I'm saying.
Yeah.
But yes, please, your question.
Yeah, I was going to ask how you guys deal with burnout. I assume when you're working with such big problems that seem kind of endless in their complexities, and as young people who are, you know, ambitious and going out and wanting to fix things, I'm sure you run into roadblocks where it's just impossible to navigate around some of these issues. Do you get overwhelmed? And if so, like, how do you deal with it?
I will start from a GHC perspective, and then you guys can add. But yes, burnout is so, so real. And I think, you know, I think there's a correlation between the types of people who are really drawn to service type work and that they don't put themselves first. And there's a reason they're doing that work. And so self-care is so, so important. In our fellowship program, we work really closely with an organization out of Boston called Still Harbor. That was started by some folks at Partners in Health who really saw burnout all around them, and that this is a really big need for folks in the social change and global health space. So we've worked with them throughout the course of the year and really unearthed concepts like resilience and vulnerability and self-reflection as a piece of developing as a leader. So that if you're not sort of looking at yourself, why you're here, what's going on for you, what's really hard, when do you need to take a step back, you're doing a disservice to the broader community that you work with. We also invest a tremendous amount in community. We're a really, really high touch program where fellows are placed in pairs, so you have your co-fellow, you also have your country cohort, and we invest in community as a source of personal emotional support as well, so that you know you're not going through something alone. And that there are people who are there to support you when you need that. So thanks for raising that, because I think that's a really good point that doesn't come up a lot. And for us, that's just like an underpinning of our curriculum. And I think being the type of leader who, you know, can step back and take care of oneself when they need to, and also push others to do the same, is really important.
I think just to, you know, piggyback what Jess said, it's just use your team. You're there for, you were hired specifically for a reason, but you're not supposed to be doing all. You can't, you possibly can't, and they know that. And so use your team, use your co-fellow, you know, go to the leadership, you know, voice your concerns, let them know, and then find tangible ways to make yourself better. And I think it's just a lot about being intentional about why you chose global health, why you want to stay domestic, or why you want to go abroad, and kind of like a self-inventory to see, can you really, you know, can this work be sustained at this point in your life? And I think as a leader, you want to be the first one up there and kind of, you know, hitting the ground running, but it really takes time to just like look back and see if this is for me right now. And I think that would help you, you know, sustainably long-term finish this project, or, you know, not burn out in a way that will affect your team and will affect your organization. So use your team around you, and, you know, don't try to take on everything on yourself.
Yeah, I think burnout is an incredibly important problem in public health in many different industries. It was interesting, like, in our fellowship here, we had people that had worked in some of the same organizations that we were all working in still, so Partners in Health or CHI. And what's interesting in some of these public health, like, communities is you almost wear your suffering as a badge of honor. Like, you're like, if you are having a harder, like, if you're having a hard time personally, and you like admit that you're struggling, like, with living in a new community and all the things that go along with that, either personally or professionally, like, that is like, you shouldn't share that, because if you can't like deal with the problems, you can't hack it, why are you here? Like, there's like literally that kind of like talking that happens in some of these organizations. And the weird thing is that these organizations are all these organizations that profess being like, hey, we're all about, you know, inclusivity and like, you know, public health and working for other people, but yet there's these weird cultural like sort of underpinnings in these organizations. And so what was interesting is hearing people's experience working in those organizations and then working in those organizations as a member of Global Health Corps. And this is one of the things that I've always really respected and admired about sort of the vision and the sort of leadership in this community, is that it is very open to the fact that this work is both hard, but it's also very personally taxing on people. And that, you know, there's no end of the tunnel. Like, you think that you're working on this stuff and you're like, oh, there's gonna be a light at the end of the tunnel where it gets easier at some point. There's no end. Like, this work is hard, and it's hard for many different reasons, many different layers. So the important part is actually building in support networks so that you can actually get through some of these hard points, when you have particularly hard points, right? And then you can celebrate the wins when you have those wins. But there's this weird, the burnout happens when you feel like you're alone and you have nobody to work with and nobody to get through the low points.
Yeah, it's personally taxing and it's personal. Like, there's a reason that you're drawn to this work. Like, there's something that you saw or you experienced. Question right there?
Sorry, this is really cool.
Go for it.
I'm a grad student, and nearing the age that you guys cut off your global health bill, so I'm like, oh, I want to know what kind of candidate you look for. You said you look beyond like clinical experience, but for most of you, do you look for MPH students or people who have professional experience? Assess the needs and the job descriptions, are those made available and apply for specific job types, or how do you source those?
Yeah, so our applicants are 21 to 30. I would say our average age of fellows is 26 to 27. Probably about half of our applicants come in with a master's degree. Very, very few are like straight out of undergrad. At least most of them have had like a couple of years working in the field. So we do tend to skew like mid-20s to older 20s. We definitely have folks who are 30 and who had two masters and have been working for 8 years as well. The positions that we develop usually run the gamut. So some of them are more appropriate for someone who has 1 year of experience, and some of them are more appropriate for someone who's a bit older. So our applications are open right now. We have two parts to our application. One is sort of a set of leadership essays, and that is about sort of what your fit with our leadership community. And then the part two of the application is actually applying to a specific job that you want. And that's about sort of the skill set. So job descriptions are live starting on December 7th, which I think was your question, right? With something else about jobs. Yes.
Just process for...
Yes, exactly. Yeah, so then you would kind of go in and you would, depending on your citizenship, you're eligible to apply for different jobs. So you can search, like, if you're really passionate about maternal and child health, or you're like, I want to work in Zambia no matter what, then I'll work on anything, or really want to work with CHI. There's different ways you can kind of filter the positions that we have. We'll have 156 of them in each of the 5 countries. I mean, total, not 156 in each. Yeah.
I think,
so we work in Malawi, Zambia, Rwanda, Uganda, and in the U.S. So Eastern Africa, Southern Africa, and Northeast of the U.S.
Yeah, and just to add, what Jess is saying, you also don't need to have a, you know, global health, public health background. It's nice for certain positions, but a lot of other positions, we have architects, we have people who are engineers, who are looking at trying to, you know, build different types of health systems in terms of, you know, the need there. So just, it's really, when they say non-traditional partners, they want to bring different people to the table and give them the opportunity to kind of, you know, like, innovative, kind of look at healthcare in a different way. And obviously, you can't have a room with all public health people all have MPH because the problem's never going to get solved. So they really want to bring in those non-traditional partners.
Yeah,
so,
yeah. Thank you. Yeah, because what grad program are you in?
I'm in the MPH, but that's my only health background. I work in international policy,
there's a lot of different, I mean, my European architects, we have engineers, we have IT people.
We do have a lot of MPHs, and we have, like, all sorts of other folks. And so last year we got about 5,600 applicants for
for 140 positions. So our acceptance rate is at 2-3%. And it was amazing to see like 40% of those applicants did not have any health background. We also have a pretty significant number coming from the private sector, like Andrew did. So that was, so that's really interesting.
40% of the people that got positions.
40% of the applicants.
Oh, of the overall
applicants. Yeah. Of the overall applicants. Fewer than that are have non-traditional. Yeah, so it sort of winnows down. You know, it's interesting because we're working with these partner organizations that are very, very like steeped in the public health sphere, and we're really championing that kind of opening up to folks from outside of the health space is an innovation. And so they're totally on board with that, but it's interesting to see that evolve over time. So our partners ultimately select. We go through this very robust 4-round selection process and give them 5 finalists, and then the partners ultimately select the fellow for their role.
So I want to talk about gender a little bit, and specifically, I'm guessing among those 5,000 applicants, we have a little bit of gender difference in the applications in terms of probably guessing by the room and our programs, a lot more women are applying than men. And so I'm interested also by your acceptance rate. Your acceptance rate reflects that gender bank background, how many girls versus men versus women are in your program. And kind of also maybe to your different panelists can address it from their perspective, but I'm interested to hear from the men why there seems to be a lack of men in the field of global health. Where are they?
Yeah, but super interesting. I'll just answer the tactical part and turn it over. So in our community overall, 65% are women. So we do definitely skew a little bit more toward women, but it's not totally drastic. And it was actually really interesting last year was to see the gender spread per country was really variant. So there were many more women than men, I think, who applied from the U.S., but in Rwanda, there were very few women and mostly men. So we have Rwanda National Fellows, and different in Malawi. So I think that there's other factors at play, but it is a really, really interesting thing to think about.
I'm happy to answer this question. You know, it's funny because I work in tech, and I've worked in tech for a long time, so the question is typically the opposite. It's like, why are there not more women in tech? And like, I don't know how much this comes up as actually as an issue even in global health in different ways. But I've been giving the leaders of GAC shit for a long time. Like, hey, like, how do we like find ways to actually create more diversity in that context? And they've done a great job to do it over the years.
For mostly women senior leadership team, all women.
But global health typically isn't. So you have all these young women
exactly.
who are coming up.
Yeah.
And the question is, are they going to reach the highest level
right.
of leadership in global health?
Right.
Or are the few men that you've chosen
mm-hmm.
going to become our leaders?
Mm-hmm.
And the road for success is so much more direct.
Mm-hmm.
And all these women are going to.
Totally. This was the thing that bothered me in, like, when I was working in it, is that it seemed like a lot of the leaders tended to actually be men still as the leaders of the organizations. When the majority of people were working at it. So I don't, like, that's what they say a lot in tech, is that they say, oh, well, like, you need to get more women involved, and they, like, hire more women, and they're like, well, you need to get more women leaders involved, because that's what, like, that's what
yeah.
I'll give them more. I don't know what the answer is, like, because you have male leaders in public health that you do. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I think I often say global health is very old, white, and male, and we're really excited about, I mean, specifically trying to sort of seed new voices and perspectives into the conversation and at the table. And for us, I think that's people of color in the U.S., that's young African voices, and it's women. And so we're really proud of the fact that we have a majority women community. And that does come up. And I think we could probably do even more sort of having internal conversations around gender equity, because I think the men that we have in our space are really important allies. And it's critical that they're thinking about gender in the same way that women are, and we're just sort of disproportionately have to think about it because it's sort of lobbed onto us. Thoughts of that?
because I'm a male. Well, I do have an MPH background, and I you know, I've always been drawn to sort of the social side of health. But I guess from my experience with Global Health Corps, yes, I was one of very few men from the American side, but on the, you know, the international side, definitely there was overwhelmingly more men. However, my co-fellow was a female. Awesome, brilliant woman. I think she will become probably the Minister of Health one day of Malawi. And I see this, you know, amongst, you know, a lot of the fellows, a lot of the, you know, we are Global Health Corps, a leadership and professional development organization, and they attract those types of individuals, and they cultivate us to become the leaders. So regardless, yes, there's more women in GHC. I really firmly believe that GHC alum are going to be climbing the ranks, and a lot of them will be women climbing the ranks, which, yes, historically it's been mostly white male, and let's wait 10, 15 years, I think it's going to really happen. So, I firmly believe in that.
What do you see as the...
I don't believe you. Okay. I'm not as optimistic.
Okay.
Only recently I was at an award ceremony where a lot of white men were awarded. They said, Heather, this is a cohort factor. This reflects academia 25 years ago. 25 years ago wasn't very long ago. That's the 1990s. There were women in academia then. There's been women in global health for decades. I think we're being too easy on ourselves. And I think that, I mean, I think it's a fabulous opportunity for Global Health Corps to include in their training and to think really strategically about how to support women through the process to leadership and not be ashamed or afraid to say, like, oh, we need to have gender diversity and equity, because, I mean, not that they don't value men with their voices, but they do, but I think there has to be some strategic, you know, thoughtful progress towards making sure that we don't just say 10 years well. 10 years from now.
I worked for CHAI, which is a predominantly, at least in Zambia, predominantly white organization. A lot of my coworkers were white. I'm Ghanaian, but born in the U.S., and I came to Zambia thinking, wow, I'm going to work with a lot of Zambians. But a lot of the Zambians I was working with were mostly maybe on the associate level. You didn't see anybody in leadership. So it was really hard to see their voice, you know, their voices being heard. They were mostly silenced when it came to a lot of, like, leadership decisions. And I think it goes back to what I say, that you have to be really intentional about the work. If you go in imposing your ideas and, you know, exerting your privilege, and you're going to fall quickly, because you're not going to see anything move, you're not going to see anything change unless you actually use the community as your partner. Our cohort in Zambia was the most diverse for our 2015-2016 year. We were the most diverse. We had a lot of African-American females, and we also saw a lot of men in our year, I think, right? In 2015, 2016, I think we have a lot of men. You know, take that as you want. But I think the point is to really kind of do an inventory and really observe and listen. Listen, like, you know, he was saying, listen first. And know that your leadership in these organizations may be not reflective of you, or may not be reflective of the community that you're serving. And that's where that kind of that non-profit paradox comes in. I'm pretty sure a lot of you guys have heard about that. But really stay true and intentional. Use your voice. I think the most thing that we saw in our organization is we were, you know, at least as the fellows, we're very, you know, encouraged to use our voice and say, wait, this is not right. Can we bring somebody from the community to help make this decision? Or can we have somebody from the community sit on this board meeting? And I think that really helped, you know, make sure that we weren't exerting what we thought was right, exerting our privilege, white privilege, educated privilege, whatever you want to call it, because we all have a type of privilege. But you are going to see it. It might, you know, at first kind of shock you. It's like, wow, I'm in this African country. Why am I the one not being heard? Why isn't the community's voice being up there? But I think you see that a lot with service work and global health. So, I mean, you have to really be intentional about the work and you know, make sure you use your voice. It doesn't have to be, it could be in different ways. It could be through writing. It can be, through mobilizing a small community and making sure that the community is heard.
Thank you so much for bringing up this topic. I'm like really invested in this topic, but I think for me what was most shocking going into the Global Health field was there's these two worlds. So there's the global health world in the U.S. where all of the policies are made in the boardrooms in D.C. and New York, and the UN headquarters are here. And then there's actually what happens in the communities on the ground and the daily realities of that. And it's really difficult to kind of navigate both of those worlds because you see so much power shifted here when, as Chad was saying earlier, most of the experts are there. And I think it all starts with all of you as college students kind of understanding what choices can I make intentionally to stop the super complex. We hear a lot about volunteerism. I know I did it in college, which is really sad when I think about it. I would go for like a month in the summer to volunteer, and it wasn't really helping anyone. And I think that's why I'm so critical of it now, because I saw what I was doing as well. And so I think it just starts with our intentional choices of really trying to build long-term systemic change and working with organizations and building our skill sets to really contribute meaningfully, and then recognizing how we can work in solidarity and move away from a charity model. I think the global health field is much more refined as the decades go on, and we're moving away from that charity model. There's still a lot of the savior complex that's still there that I see all the time, and it makes me so sad. But I think it's getting better. And especially as you start all entering leadership roles, I think your generation is a lot more sensitive to that context.
I think we work really hard to instill in our fellows the value of humility, and we specifically select that from our applicants. I do a lot of training with our fellows and our alumni on how to find and build and use their voices as leaders and how that can be an effective method of change. And an important piece of that is knowing when not to use your voice and knowing when to just be quiet. And that, I think, can be the most powerful thing of all. And I don't doubt that anyone in our community or anyone in the public health field is really well-intentioned, and that's obviously not good enough, and sometimes the way that you help is just by sitting and listening and watching. And we really try to kind of surface those issues early on and just have those discussions. The co-fellow model for us is also really important, I think, checking balance. So every fellow has their co-fellows from another country. So if you're working in Malawi as American, your co-fellow is Malawian. Or if you're Malawian working in the US, your co-fellow is American. And that's sort of designed to build in this 360-degree cross-cultural collaboration. And we talk about cultural humility from the get-go. When we have fellows submit pieces to our Medium publication, I ask them to have their co-fellow read it first. And like, I can't read one more like white girl in Africa piece. And it's, and again, there's the intention is there, and it's amazing how much blindness we all have, every single one of us. And it doesn't mean we're bad people, it's just the reality. And so also this piece of vulnerability, which we talk a lot about, you need to have the grit to like have a hard conversation and allow yourself to be called out and be like, yeah, like I didn't mean to be, such a huge jerk, and I completely was, and now I know. So those are some ways, both formally and informally, we just try to kind of keep it something that we're constantly talking about because it's real and it's easy to slip into it, and it can be totally unconscious, which is really scary, so you have to find ways to catch it.
Hi, I'm Jacqueline. I'm working right now in community engagement and outreach at USC Environmental Health, and I also did some work abroad briefly for a PhD student in biological conservation in Madagascar. So I understand some of the things you're talking about with working with people and also being Hispanic and working for Hispanic nonprofits with USC Environmental Health. I see what you guys are saying about that. But anyway, I'm also an undergrad in environmental studies. But what I'm really interested in is actually psychology research. And especially using that to connect with communities as efficiently as possible. And I know you guys have, it's not always about necessarily about efficiency. It's about connecting with people on a personal level, but I'm just interested in how we can do that better. And I was wondering if you think there's any room for psychology research in global health or in your organization. So I'm kind of seeking that path as to figure out what, how do we get the behavior change? Like, you know, what is proven, or what are some ways that we can maybe get the behavior change that we're looking for? So yeah. For example, like I think about the ways that we're, this is a not an abroad, this is a U.S. example, California example, how do we use like media about water conservation to actually get a behavior change in people? So like for example, I've, from what I have read in textbooks, one thing that works is telling people, letting people know, or leaving a sign on their door that says that their neighbors are saving this much water or this much money on something. And that works better than telling them that they could, the competition between neighbors works better than other methods that we would think work well. So that's the kind of thing that I'm interested in like hacking into, I guess. So I was just curious if you think that that's something worthwhile or useful in global health.
I mean, I think that that kind of, you know, that sort of community responsive approach is really important. I don't know that like psychological research needs to be the basis of it. I think, I guess, just going back to some of the themes that have been surfaced in terms of just like being there and listening and observing and kind of understanding, like, you know, that's I think how we've seen really interesting health programming innovations. You know, like the use of hairdressers as folks who give out information about birth control, or, you know, the use of text messages to do so. And so I guess you could come at it from a psychological perspective. It's also like market-based research. It's like what matters to people, like what's the broader sphere of like what they're going through in their life. Because certainly nobody makes a health decision in a vacuum, right? You're always, you know, you have competing priorities of your time, of your money. So I do think there's a role for that type of approach. I don't know if anyone else has thoughts.
I think I struggled a lot kind of going between behavior change and systemic changes and thinking about behavior change in very poor communities where we think about choice and agency and how there's a lot of lack of that, and how, so for example, about 20 years ago when the HIV/AIDS like activism movement started, there was one of the senior leaders of the World Health Organization, and he said that, you know, Africans can't tell time, so that's one of the reasons why HIV/AIDS medication shouldn't be delivered to these communities. So as global health leaders, we can really use behavior, like reasons for, to engage in behavior change, like sometimes negatively against communities.
Yeah.
So really thinking about also structural inequalities and how that like intertwines and poverty and all these real social issues and structural issues and how that intertwines with the behaviors and the choices that people make every day in these communities. So I definitely think there's a place for it, but also to kind of see it in context in terms of the community that you're working with and how as leaders can sometimes use it negatively or positively, but oftentimes it seems like it's to talk against communities and otherize them and make excuses for why things, why interventions are not being done in those communities.
Hi.
And my question was, how do you deal with, I guess, the aftermath of whatever intervention or programs you do for that year? What happens when you guys?
Good question. Generally speaking, we often have new fellows coming in, so we tend to work with the same partners over time. So there's about a 1-month overlap between an outgoing fellow and an incoming fellow.
where they're building in kind of the transfer of work. That doesn't always happen. Sometimes there are new fellowship roles, so someone isn't taking that year, and sometimes we don't work with the same partner. So obviously the issue of building an institutional knowledge is really important. And investing in the broader system so that when you leave, I mean, 13 months is not a long time. It's not like you're gonna finish something and be like, great, done, I did it. So thinking about that when you're coming in. I don't know if you guys have any specific examples to share.
Yeah, I think depending on your placement organization and where you work, sometimes you'll have something tangible that you would need to deliver, or sometimes it's kind of working with the community to maybe approve something. And so my particular organization, there were no fellows there, and there's no fellows after me. So we actually created a business plan, and that business plan is now being, it's at the Ministry of Health, and it's, you know, it's in talks with different investors. So our specifically, because it was kind of like an actual, we need to build a manufacturing plant, there's kind of like a blueprint of something that we can give in. But I know some organizations who work with community health workers are just maybe improving a system or trying to create new interventions, and something like that, you would have new incoming fellows or somebody who works on your team already kind of just take that on. And I think community is a big thing because you always keep in contact. I mean, till this day, I know some fellows are still in touch with their organizations and just checking in and just seeing how things are going. So it's never like your work is done once you leave the country. It's even more meaningful. So you can kind of go back and kind of follow it and see what's going on and seeing, oh, I kind of helped put that together.
Also, there's opportunities for those fellows to continue working for the organization. That's probably why they expressed, you know, the decline to have more fellows, because they, you know, took on that fellow to continue.
As a permanent position.
As a permanent position.
That's
so there's opportunities.
They'll hire you as a permanent position.
We do see a lot of our fellows are sort of immediately hired into their partner organizations or other partner organizations, and we see kind of a layering effect where we have last year's fellows, now the supervisor, this year's fellow. We have kind of three or four generations in management, which is really fun.
I was just wondering what skills, whether technical or non-technical, do you maybe wish you had known before going into your respective fields, or like, what do you think are skills that are like a big gap?
I don't know, for me it's very different because it was very specific to creating a product. So for me, I think it would be like supply chain management. Like a lot of my work was just all supply chain management, trying to procure inputs to make this baby food. And so I learned none of that in public health, and, you know, and so I think that just kind of gives us a reason to kind of maybe take classes outside of public health, and it kind of helps, you know, give you more robust skill set that you can kind of transfer over to other things. I know you were working in global health, and now you're in, you know, private sector and tech. A lot of these things can transfer over. So I think strengthening skills that you wouldn't otherwise think, you know, like you can all say have staff skills or have SPSS, but sometimes you're not even using that on the job. They want you to have other types, like, you know, project management and supply chain. So it's good to kind of touch on non-traditional classes and take an econ class, take a business class, and you'll definitely be able to apply that.
And to add, GHC has a professional development fund where each fellow receives, I think, on this day, $500 or $600 to strengthen some of these skills that they can put into their toolbox. So I definitely, you know, use my monies to strengthen my M&E skills. So that's something to look forward to, especially for global health.
You guys, because you're not, like, you're still in school and you're trying to figure out what classes you
want
to
what's take. The hot skills, though?
I'm an international health major, but I was thinking about minoring in like geospatial intelligence, which I know is like.
Give us like 10 second, like what is that? Just asking for a friend.
It's like it's like using like GIS and like using geospatial technology to map. And predict like the impacts of, like, say, for example, a disaster, a certain event that might occur that would affect human populations and affect human security.
Yeah. That's smart. That's really good to have.
Yeah, and I think that's a skill that not many people have already. So I did some work with GIS, and I'm continue to work with this organization called Map Your World that does GIS mapping and empowers youth to collect stories and tell the stories of the community and affect change through advocacy. But I mean, with GHC, you know, I would have wanted to sort of implement maybe a project with GIS, but there was no need for the organization that I was working with. So, you know, to implement a project. But I'm not sure, you know, with this year and GIS now being sort of that buzz thing, maybe there might be some opportunities in some of these job descriptions that are looking for this skill set. And there's a lot of online, you know, curriculum to bolster that GIS, you know, skills.
I'm biased, and this is a skill I do have, but I think one of the most important skills that anyone can come into the field of public health or global health, or really anywhere, is the ability to tell a good story and the ability to write. And that's something that's really important for each one of our fellows. And whether or not you're going to be a writer and you want to be writing op-eds, or you just need to write a report for your boss, or you're telling a story orally in an interview or at the Thanksgiving table, knowing how to convey what you know and what you feel in a meaningful way to a particular audience is like the most critical skill of all. Because that's how you get somebody to say yes to you. That's how you get the job. That's how you move the needle. That's how you convince the Minister of Health. That's how you get in the door. So I think that is once and always will be a hot skill.
Yeah, I also say public speaking is the biggest thing that I think about all the time, especially as a leader. Like the way you actually impact and influence like large groups of people, like you can do it through writing or you can do it through public speaking. Public speaking tends to be a very like engaging experience when you're talking to people. But it's something that nobody's naturally good at. Seriously, like and people that are, you just gotta do it, right?
Yeah.
And so I remember when I was in school, I would force myself to be like, well, everybody would be like, work on a, you know, group project, and be like, who's gonna present? And nobody wants to present. You're also not wanting to present. But like, I was like, fuck it, I'm gonna present it, because there's no other way to get experience. You have to do it. So the next, how many ever years you have left in school, like, be the one that volunteers to present every single.
So I wanted to go back quickly to Sonya's comment about kind of the white savior and oh my god, in college I've been on these short trips and I'm horrified. So I'm interested in kind of thinking about what rules you think universities should abide by when sending students abroad, recognizing that you had over 5,000 people apply for this type of opportunity and only take a small portion. We have thousands of students who are coming and claiming for these type of opportunities. And while we recognize it, we also recognize the powerful impact they can have on their life in becoming dedicated to these types of careers. So without being able to like, just don't send them,
right?
Because that's not a viable solution for us. What do you think some of these rules should be for us when we're thinking about providing these opportunities to our students?
Yeah, I just want to say this. It's funny you ask about that because we've been saying like a month. I'm like, well, I kind of felt like, I think a lot of what I think about it in terms of, and when I talk about college, because we all have this kind of same experience, and like over, and it's like, well, it's a long time to become part of the community. It takes a really long time. So when do you actually become part of the community? So we wrestled up with that a lot, just personally, and I'd say like. I don't know, like an important piece is just being honest with the value that is coming out of that. That it's like, it actually may be more valuable for me personally rather than the community. And if you can be open about that as a concept with the students that you're working with, I think that that's, it's possible. Like, it makes it so that at least you're clear with like, I'm kind of being selfish with my time and taking this from the organization.
Yeah, I think I agree. It's not an option to not go, and I don't think that really helps us at all because I think it's important to experience different places and spaces and people. But I think it's not about going, but it's the mindset. And so it's sort of putting people through whether it's, you know, a course and a set of readings from, you know, people from that country, reading poets, reading literature from there, understanding the politics and the history, understanding colonialism and the broader sphere so that you're not going in, you're not dropping in a vacuum, which again is like, it's not ill-intentioned, it's just because, right, like who writes our history books, you know, what do we learn in history class, like not all that much, not the whole truth. And so if we can frame it in a way that's like, this is a holistic experience and it's a privilege to travel and to be in other places, and that I think like Andrew said, like it is about you and not them, then I think it can be like a really healing and transformative experience.
I'd say one more thing, just regardless of how small the time is, because we do this with like, we don't tend to take a lot of interns on at my company now, but like we do, it's about structuring the work that they have where there can be a tangible project that they have that comes out of that time. So really, no matter how short the time can be, if you can still add value, it needs to be, you know, compartmentalized at work so that there's like, cool, I mean, I had a certain day, instead of just kind of showing up and being like, oh, I'm just kind of here to do a job shadow for a week, right? Which is both good for the organization and it's good for the people that are students.
I think we have time for maybe one more question.
Yes,
you.
I had a question just for the fellowship. Just can you explain like what it entails?
Yes.
Like, is it like a full-time job? Is it more school?
Yes, it is a full-time job. So it's a it's a lifestyle. It's a 13-month paid fellowship. It includes a full-time paid position within a health organization. So you're working day in and day out in a particular job that you apply to. And then in addition to that, you're part of the Global Health Core Leadership Community. And so that means you have a co-fellow, you're part of a cohort, you're very, very like solidly cemented into a leadership network of other emerging leaders. We bring our fellows together 5 times throughout the year for leadership development training. And then there's sort of a number of informal, ongoing coaching, support aspects of it. But yes, it's a job and it's a leadership accelerator at the same time, in a nutshell. And if you want to find out more about the application process, about the program, about where to work, et cetera, just go to our website and you'll very easily find it. It's Global Health Core, ghcore.org/apply. And applications are open until January 18th. And I'm happy to leave my card too if you have any questions at all. As a follow-up, I'm happy to email with you or get on the phone or anything like that. And I just want to thank everyone for spending the afternoon with us. And I want to thank you guys so much for taking the time to be here. It was really special.